We're creating something that has
yeah.
a compression of energy.
I want to help with that.
You are already by coming.
Because I'm going to be here for 5 months in New York, not in New York. Mm-hmm. I'm in Long Island.
Okay.
But I will try to come here every single weekend.
Whenever you can, man.
So, yeah, for sure.
I have good people in Long Island. I know that's what we're creating, a community outwards, like Alex Gray is. And there's this girl who gave me this. Oh, you have to come over and look at my... this is where I keep all my drugs, on my psychedelic table. So when I do mushrooms, usually I light him.
Uh-huh.
This is my girl. She smokes with me. So this girl from Long Island gave me petrified wood and some other shells from Long Island, just some intention.
Wow.
I put like little symbols and imagery. This is a little baby crazy guy. And then I keep all my drugs in here, in the Owl of Wisdom.
Wow.
See? And then that book is the Terence McKenna's book, Food for the Gods. I don't know if you read that. Terence McKenna is one of the first.
Yeah, for sure.
His brother goes to tells him all the time.
I cited him in my work.
Yeah.
Because Terence McKenna said that he talked about experience and existence. Yeah. So he said that supposing that you can take off the pineal gland is involved with two neurotransmitters. They work in the same receptor.
Mm-hmm.
So he said like, one of them is melatonin, and the other one is DMT. Because the thing about DMT,
melatonin,
I think it
helps you with your sleep cycles.
Yeah.
And that's when your unconscious comes out.
Yeah.
So melatonin might be the doorway to the unconscious.
Yeah. So he said, imagine that you don't have melatonin. It never existed. And just DMT. Because they are just same keys for the same lock. Different keys from the same lock.
Okay.
So imagine if it doesn't exist, the melatonin. The reality would be the trip of DMT.
Oh, okay. So, melatonin, okay.
So, what's the reality? I mean, if melatonin never existed, the reality would be the trip of DMT.
That's how we would experience reality.
Yeah. So, it's based, that argument for me, it basically opens the mind that reality is just seeing just keys in different locks.
Keys and locks is one metaphor. And then frameworks is another metaphor. Programming is another metaphor. Visual metaphors. So I think what I realized on my trip yesterday is I'm trying to do with words what Alex Gray does with painting. He visually represents wisdom from the psychedelic realm. And I'm trying to, with words, bring back wisdom. But that's what a shaman does. Travels into that unconscious, or whatever you want to call it, into that reality that's separate from our experience. Our sober experience is one reality. They venture into other experiences, which represent a fraction of the greater reality. And what you just said is that biologically, we're wired with doors to both realities naturally. And if we close one door, all we would have is a psychedelic. That's interesting.
Yeah.
So sometimes we drop the microphone and we like, this whole room. What I want to do is I want to turn it into a creation room. So when you guys stay here, you come here and we record and we create either music or words or paint.
Wow.
I'm going to erase all this so you guys could like, we're going to do a story. So every guest puts a different sentence. And once we finish the story, we take a picture and we start over.
Wow.
That'd be cool, right? With different colors. Every line is a different color. So we got ideas. I just started this January, but I was doing real estate. This is who I was. I guess who I still am, but I'm trying to be more myself. So that's my real estate business. So I make good money to live here. This is a $2,600 place. But yeah, I was unhappy. And I was like, you know what? So I invited two of my friends, female energy, to balance me out. Because real estate's a lot of aggressiveness. And then with the travelers, I'm getting a lot of it. The apartment, we're just like stirring it up, and it's really cool.
Yeah.
I haven't even shown you the roof. The roof's the best part.
Yeah, I went to.
You went?
There.
So you see the whole fucking. Yeah, that's cool. So I have my couch up there. And then when the weather gets better, we put the tent. That's the pictures you saw.
Yeah. I was telling to my best friend, because my best friend's going to come here on June, and also another one. And there are my family. So I was telling, okay, it's the first place that I've been. I mean, because I'm actually staying at a house from a friend, sleeping on the floor the last weekend. But he's not, we are totally different. I mean, he's just, he's a good guy, but it's just, you know, he has no thing. It's so simple.
Passion, yeah, exactly.
So I was kind of, okay, he's giving me a place to live, and that's, I'm really grateful about that, but I need something else.
Yeah.
And I told to my best friend, I have the place. And I didn't even met you, so now it's I need to think about
this right here. If you feel these are actual stones. Like, there's a lot of intention everywhere.
Yeah.
So, like, just, like, physically or, like, I don't know what. Like, I love these little containers. But, like, all this little stuff is, like, a life. And we're still collecting. But, like, half of the stuff I have in my apartment I got from other people. So, it's... I don't know. It's, we've got potential to create in here. That's the idea. Potential to create. Here, so let me make sure I settle you up. So you're here, so we can put all your stuff on this now. So
okay.
Sorry. Just so we can make sure we're organizing.
Yeah. It's just this, and that's it.
Perfect. And then this is JJ, but JJ's taking off. JJ, there's no rush. You take off whenever you want, okay? She's going to be coming back soon, hopefully. We just went around the corner and bought some tea. Oh, homeboy, Joey. If you like that calming blend, I got you 4 ounces.
Oh, okay. Yeah, thank you.
Right. As a gift to take home.
That's awesome. Thank you. Oh,
yeah, that's the best place. Oh, you know what? It has stevia leaves. That's why it tastes a little sweet.
Oh, it does?
The guy told me. Not the sugar, but just the leaves is enough to, like...
Yeah, make it sweet.
Yeah. What was the name again, my friend?
Gonzalo. All my friends call me Talo.
Talo. Porque
Z A L O or Gon? Gon, it's easier.
Gon. I like Gon. Gon. Mi mamá is Guillermina González. Gonzalo.
González mean son of Gonzalo.
Yeah. Es de Gonzalo.
So where is she from?
Es de México. Guadalajara.
Uh-huh.
Pero su familia, sus papás de papás son de España. Entonces, González con un... I don't know. But like she said, like, I think the S is from Spain, the Z is from Mexico, something. I don't know. Go on. I like that. And you're from Spain, right?
Yeah, from Madrid.
Madrid is really cool, I heard.
Yeah. We have still... We're still being community, I think. And I didn't know that till I come here.
That you still have a community? What, society? Or? Yeah.
It's becoming, you know, weak.
That's
because
really interesting.
Of the past years, we are getting more individual.
Yeah.
But still being more society down here.
But that's an amazing talent that you have, that sensitivity. Not many people can come here and recognize what's different between here and other communities. I recognize that too.
I'm always thinking and feeling things.
My brother too, he lives in Mexico City. He used to live here and he moved. He said, Mexico has a different sense of community. People talk to each other on the street and
help to each other.
Yeah. And New York is very individual. I mean, there's a sense of community, but there's also a sense of aggression here, more so. So, yeah.
And for me, I love music and I have like 6 different playlists just for New York. So, have one playlist for Brooklyn, one playlist for Manhattan.
Oh, why not? I got a speaker in here. Look, so this right here, I've been asking people to use a speaker. Here is a Bluetooth speaker for the hostel. So put on a playlist. Yeah, you just gotta find it. I'll plug it in. That would be dope. Gonzalo, going with your energy, maybe we'll get the tent on the roof. I've been kind of lazy, but I've been wanting to get the tent on the roof.
Trust me that it's not gonna be my last time here, so you'll have time to do it.
Oh, so the shower? Yeah, I should give you the whole tour. The shower's right here, that's funny. I'll let you let a few jokes. And then the bathroom's in the hallway, I'll show you that.
Yeah, I went there.
Oh,
I went to the rooftop to
You already explored.
Yeah.
Look at that, we're attracting the urban nomads.
Right.
The Buddha bums.
Buddha bums?
You ever read that book Dharma Bums? Any Jack Kerouac? Really good old beatnik generation. They were very much trying to meet other fucking hippies and figure out the world. And they actually lived in the village. When they would come to New York, this was their neighborhood. So what I was thinking, Joe, you can give me your opinion on this. I only rent out the bottom beds anyways. So Airbnb guys go down here, curtains to give you privacy.
Totally.
I want to be able to let you guys like shut out the world.
Yeah.
You could kind of do it up here, but you kind of like still get that like catching people's eyesight.
Uh-huh.
So these will be like the public hangout areas, but these will be your private. And when I'm not overpacked, like right now there's three people, so someone gets to hang out up here. But the two people who are booking through Airbnb get their own like cubbies.
Great idea. Yeah,
okay?
Totally.
And I already have one iPad, so I get another iPad and then get your little mini TVs in there.
Yeah. It'd probably be easy to put curtains up for the TV.
Yeah, super. I'm just going to put fishing wire
with
some attachments and then just some fabric. Cut it and then fold it over itself, tie it, bunch it. I know how to make a curtain.
Yeah. That's awesome.
Yeah, that's a good idea. I thought about last night being in that cubby drinking my tea. I was like, this is cool, but like if I wanted my own me time,
yeah,
I could imagine how I could just shut it all off.
Totally.
Like, I really like the feeling down there. You feel tucked away.
Yeah.
It's cool. I gotta listen to JJ toss and turn all night. No, I'm just joking. I'm surprised how many people you could put in here comfortably.
Uh-huh.
No. It's not. This motherfucker, he bought two Gatorades.
Oh, that was the kid.
Yeah, I poured out one of his Gatorades. He bought two, so he knew that he was drunk and he was like...
That's funny.
Some guy came here. He stayed in the bed, Japanese kid, young, like 20, and then he walked into Yaya's room, and I was in the room with her, and the guy walked in and started climbing on the bed, and then we're like, what? And I kicked him out that night, and then he left the Gatorade, so I made him drink it. But like, I told him, you gotta go, it was like 3 a.m, I took his stuff and just threw it out. But everyone else has been nice. I'm trying to bring him in him. A lot of young energy, but he like was really respectful.
Uh-huh.
Like I asked him one night, the night you didn't come home, I was like, I was afraid you're gonna come home drunk, and he was like, no, I'm respecting the place. I'm like, I appreciate it.
Mm-hmm. So. Was he 26 or something?
20, yeah.
26.
But he was trying to turn up. I got that energy. He was like cruising.
Yeah.
So I was like, that's cool. Just don't come home stupid.
Yeah.
Trying to be like the cool house mother. The RA. I'm like an RA.
You're
like
an RA. Totally. You're good at it.
I mean, you learn, so like I could be a little naive too.
That's funny.
Small margin of error, the girls will shut this place down quick if they don't feel comfortable.
Right.
This will be an extra bed. We don't have anyone checking in until Monday.
I forgot about you going.
I got you. I knew you were coming today, but I should have known.
Between 12 and 2, you can always come in this room, hang out, and between 12 and 2, this has the best light. So now the sun's just coming in here. So if you ever want to come in here, read or just hang out.
Check in list and then just hand it to people. Wi-Fi passwords. Right,
okay.
Here.
Okay.
you get really nice conscious people, and sometimes you just get travelers. So eventually we're now the enough people. You guys are picking up whenever you come to New York. So this is cool to see if I have space, but I only advertise 2 bits and not 4 bits. So even if you don't see space available here, just hit me up and I'll tell you about it.
Okay,
so it's like underground.
So in June, my friends have to confirm that they're coming, but they have to confirm in that month, because this month, because they have to start with the visa thing.
Just give me a heads up.
So I will, if they come here, for sure, they will be able to stay
for longer.
No, but I would like to know to meet my friends. Because I love starting people.
And
it's the best way to know each other.
Yeah, and there's a whole other stuff I would talk to you about. There's a, you know, I was in that, you know, Occupy Wall Street, Los Ocupados in Spain. That's where it started. So, like, I was in that here. I was arrested and all that protesting. And so, watch, let me show you something.
So, I would love to go to Spain. That's part of the book that I'm writing. I need to go to Spain to research the history of that. Because it started over there. So, we borrowed.
Shit now, because
oh, yeah.
The multicultural town in Madrid is Calapies. There's a place where all the African people live, and a few days ago one of them died because the police didn't help him, and the guy he told us they killed the guy that they killed. Of my friends are African. They're pretty. They're not angry. They're peaceful. One of my best friends was
fucking.
The media almost cried. How do you get this? I didn't tell me. It wasn't political till some months then, but it emerged a voice of that, and it was, oh, this is great, it is going to change everything. So
exactly
they went to the election, and they got the 40%. That is crazy, because in Spain we just have two political parties, and it was like, okay, it's gonna change, it's gonna be different, and now they're becoming the same,
mm-hmm.
and we lost the roots mm-hmm. of the movement.
Daesis.
Yeah.
I have a tattoo of roots.
Yo trabajo en bienes raíces, se llaman. Bienes raíces. What does that mean? The roots of wealth.
Yeah.
The roots of goods. Because real estate is what's important. Land son los raíces de las bienes, the goods. The root of wealth is real estate. So our protest, our most effective protest, was when we occupied real estate. Because that's the beginning of power, is owning the land under your feet. And so we went to a public land, which is supposed to be public, and we claimed it as the public for the public. And reason is, wisdom is defended by reason. And why societies and why it's, you know, yeah, what is it? Systems of logic are defended by reason. Systems of violence are defended through violence. So they didn't talk to us. They
yeah.
forced us out of there.
Yeah, but the sad thing is, in Spain now, the thing is happening is they're protesting, but there's also pretty much violence of people that they're not really interested in the topic. It's just violence and violence. And then the media, the information that the other people get is
okay.
they burn a motorcycle. They burn...
They want you to communicate in the language of violence because that doesn't expose the violent society. Because then the violent society has an excuse to communicate a language of violence back. But the violent society only has the language of violence. So when you speak to them in the language of reason, they can't speak to you back. So if you speak to them with reason, they speak violence. And if you speak to them with violence, they speak violence. But when you speak to them with violence, they speak violence. From the outside, you're judged. If you speak to them with reason and they speak violence, from
yeah.
the outside, they're judged. And that's what Gandhi did. He spoke to his system with reason, let them speak back in violence, and he let the world condemn them. And that's how you nonviolently protest him.
I said to my friend, one of the black guys, that for me, I was thinking here, that the best protest maybe is just silence. Imagine
mm-hmm.
like 3,000 people just, you don't have to claim nothing, because everything, I mean, they're shouting, they're screaming, like, cops are murderers. I mean, it's not that true. I respect, totally respect your cause, but you cannot generalize, because then they're gonna be angry too. So maybe the best protest would be just silence for 1 hour, 2 hours, just walking, 3,000 people, silence.
I never like the energy that they get us when we're protesting. There's people who say, shout, scream, this is what democracy looks like. Democracy doesn't look like people shouting on the street. It looks like people thinking and talking. Democracy isn't... There's a lot of things wrong with the protest. What's interesting is you point out the pattern that happened over there is the same pattern over here. I documented it over here. So I wasn't in Spain, but over here, whatever protests we had and ideals were eventually turned into the system. I documented that here. So I have the bank accounts from the protest movement. People were leaking me the bank accounts. I have a documentary of the whole, like, if you look over here, this is a whole protest movement right here. I have, I spent $300 of my own money to pay a guy to follow me for a whole day through the protest, and then I documented, like, 17 hours of the whole protest movement. So I could actually, like, when I talk to you, when I write my book, well, it's in the process, but this will be, like, the supporting documents to back it up. Like, this is all... Like, these are all real people I talk to in the movement who are actually trying to do good. I think people do this in Spain. People must have documented it over there.
Yeah.
But, yeah this is, let's see, one more. This just shows you an idea. So, I was giving a proposal to the General Assembly. So we had General Assemblies. We had people talking in groups. This is all we were doing, is we were getting together and trying to figure out the direction of the movement. This is where your political party came from. It came from the protest movement, which organized itself politically, and then eventually it went into the system, and along that path they got taken over. And so this is the beginning. See, these people back here weren't with us in the park. These
yeah.
people are people who came later, who were there just to push us into the system. That's what I think. And
okay.
I have proof of it. So you have a bunch of like I still talk to this girl. Like, I know a lot of these guys were like, it's like, what are you doing now? They're like, they're making money. I looked up some of them. Some of them are making really good money around the world. And I'm like, you guys just came here as a job. Someone paid you to come here and do that. So this is like, I was on the street doing shit. Fucking, this is a guy who was handling all of our donations of clothes and stuff. But I have a lot of material.
It's funny because in the...
This is a park where we protested. This was our square. And see, this guy's an old guy who's just sitting there just watching. He's just...
So, in Spain, that political party that came from this thing, now it's government in Madrid. They don't have the whole country, but they're in Madrid. And it's been 30 years, because in Spain we have just 40 years of democracy, of what they call democracy, I mean. But in 40 years, it never happened that thing that is happening now with this political party, that it was supposed to be it was emerged like this, and now they avoided the skateboarding anywhere.
What?
I cannot skate anywhere. Not in the sidewalk, not in the in the road, anywhere. And if you skate, you're gonna have to have problems. So
one of the diverging factors are society's fucked up. Energy comes to improve society. The energy starts going up. There's an anarchist idea where you need less authority and you allow people to solve their own problems. That's actually a democratic idea. This is my social security number on my arm. I'm a very big anarchist. Less authority. This is the biggest problem. Whoever put that number on my arm. I didn't. I was born with it. So authority that claims all authority, including no right to skate. That's one way. And then, so the anarchist way is less authority, and you just trust that people can get together to solve their problems. Some people believe that would be chaos. If you look up the definition of anarchy, one definition says chaos, the other definition says utopia. Says that we do not need authority. So I believe just as little as possible, but you work towards it. The other way says that we're going to improve the world, this messed up world, if we improve human nature. And so they put all their efforts into changing people to make them better. So the anarchists say trust people, and we just need better tools of communication. And that's what you have, prefigurative politics. You have actually words and ideas which describe how to do that. The change people, make them better, is how you get dictators control, communists. They say, oh, we have utopia, but you just have to trust the state, trust the central power to tell you how to live. And that's where they tell you, don't skateboard. And they do it from the same place. They say, we all want to improve society, but there's certain people, and I notice them in the protest movement right away, who say, we just need the right people in charge. That's not. It's not that everyone is corruptible. We don't need the right people. We need to open up all of the avenues to power. We need to take off all of the, you know, people are stepping on democracy. They have the heel on the neck of democracy. We need to take that off. That's all. We just need to open it up like a garden and let it grow itself. And then we have to weed a little bit, light gardening. But these people are gardening like Monsanto with chemicals. And for every extra law is another fertilizer and chemical and pesticide. And they kill you. It's like you kill the culture. How much wisdom and freedom and beauty has come from skating culture, which has developed? It's a young culture. It's younger than hip hop. You know, it's like, I don't know. So that's obviously on face value bad.
Yeah.
Because culture, that's what connects you. Like, skating culture started here, and now it's all around the world, like hip hop. So it connects people around the world.
And it has values.
Yeah.
I mean, if you're a skater, you're going to be always with this street.
It's a community. Like you said, you don't like to skate by yourself. Now you come here and you find another community.
That's a big point, but it also creates a connection with the street, we see possibilities in the street. We're always in street skating. You meet homeless. You meet every people from the street.
It might be an urban way to renew. Skating is a human urban renewal. It's like from the ground up. My brother, he's gay, and he was telling me that homosexuality might be a way for our world to heal itself. He said that in nature, you'll find when animals are stressed, some of them will start turning gay. It might be a way for the population to start protecting itself. We need, you know, so like skating might be like something that came up out of our urban
yeah.
sickness. It's like the skaters are like the mushrooms of the fucking city. Going into all the cracks and fucking through
play. Yeah, we're like
oh,
rats.
This is, yeah, this is gone.
Yeah.
Oh, you met him?
Yeah, he was in the door.
Sorry, I didn't know he was coming. I tried not to surprise you.
That's okay.
How do you like the coffee?
It's really good. Where is it from?
Puerto Rico. It's right down the street. It's really good, right? I have to show you around.
The so-called disclosures of the rattlesnake critics. This conference is either a clinic or a morgue, and the speakers are pathologists or coroners muttering over a corpse. So far as I'm concerned, in the quarter hour allotted to me, I shall not dwell long on the fact that there's been an illness in the family, and I shall assume, for the time being at least, that whatever internal upsets there may have been in the recent past, we are now, at long last, about to work together to remove the obstacles in the way of healthy and uninterrupted progress. I doubt whether anything short of visible, palpable, undeniable accomplishment on a big scale will answer the critics, or whether the average citizen will ever grasp how complex, aggravating, and thankless our task has been. Few comprehend the differences between the various types of low, middle, and high-income slum clearance housing, their interrelation, the place of each, the logical balance of business and industry, the difficulty of attracting sponsors, moving people, gradual demolition and piecemeal building, and how easy it is for sidewalk superintendents to bend down and sling mud and rocks lifted from the excavations. It is not to be wondered at that there have been misunderstandings and charges, some justified, some random, and some malicious. No doubt there have been here and there cases of official ineptitude and even dereliction, and instances of cowardice, timidity, and weakness. There has, however, been more nonfeasance than misfeasance. The crime has been primarily that of the unlit lamp and the ungirt loin. It is astounding that anyone in local elective or appointed office, anyone with capital and plenty of places to risk it, any cooperative group, any prudent conservative bank or loaning agencies not compelled to do so, has been willing to run the gauntlet and brave the brickbats, rotten eggs, and dead cats on the way to slum clearance. There have never been, at any given time, many entrepreneurs with a thirst for martyrdom as well as adventure. And when they are expected to give up their money as well as their lives, the available list becomes alarmingly small. As to public officials, those of us who have survived are by now clothed in the tough, impenetrable armor of a rhinoceros. They care little for compliments or rewards beyond the satisfaction of the game itself. Even the ultimate prospect of thumbing our noses at religious bigots, mudslingers, and kibitzers has ceased to have any attraction. Let me now state categorically what I believe to be the conditions under which we can expedite the present and somewhat expanded program so as to finish work too long delayed and meet the problems of recession and unemployment. One. First and foremost, do not assume that what may work in a town of 50,000 is gospel in New York with 8.5 million. If you're looking for private capital, you can't, in a city like this, persuade elected officers, the press, and public to condemn and clear slums first and then look around for sponsors afterwards. You must snare them first. Is there anyone dumb enough to think any committee on slum clearance could persuade the governing body of New York, with its shortage of capital funds, to condemn 50-odd acres of congested land in the center of Manhattan, like the Lincoln Square area, put out the tenants and raise the buildings, in the hope that in a year or so, sponsors of music, education, housing, and whatnot would turn up eager to pay any old price to bail the city out. Two, we must have much less red tape, minute regulation, changes in procedure, letter writing for the record, and arbitrary orders from Washington and its regional branches. All Title I projects must be processed much faster. We are supposed to be partners, not enemies, in this enterprise. Three, we must have lower interest rates on mortgage money and the elimination or cutting in half of the federal 0.5% service exaction. Present rates are prohibitive. Four, we must have reliable, speculative sponsors for full tax-paying, high rental housing, and these can be enlisted only if they are allowed to proceed on a normal business basis. Five, to achieve middle-income housing at moderate rentals, we must have more nonprofit cooperative housing largely involving trades unions, and they must receive genuine FHA and conventional banking help, such as has been denied them so far. Six, we must have a 45% city real estate tax exemption for a reasonable period of amortization, as well as lower mortgage rates to produce middle-income housing. Seven, we must have some additional low-rental, fully subsidized housing to provide for eligible tenants removed from Title I projects and from the rights of way and sites of other public improvements. If we must cope with large yearly permanent additions to our population from outside, say 25,000 from Puerto Rico alone, we require decent housing for them. At a cost of $3,000 a person for such housing, we shall need at least $75 million yearly for some time, unless a depression keeps these prospective immigrants at home. Where that is coming from, I don't know. It's no exaggerated figure. Eight, the most dramatic opportunity in New York for a big middle income, and in this instance I mean a $20 a room nonprofit cooperative project, on vacant centrally located land is at the old Jamaica Tract in Queens, where we could accommodate easily 25,000 people drawn out of the slums if we could get cooperation, reasonably cheap money, and a 45% real estate tax exemption during amortization. This would have to come under the redevelopment law, not under Title I. Nine, when all is said and done, the best instrument available to employ people, stimulate business, and produce vitally needed improvements is the federal housing program, and particularly the FHA and all of its ramifications. Don't forget that the FHA produced a lot of housing after World War II. Angry veterans and their hysterical families wanted a roof over their heads and didn't care a damn how they got it or what it cost. Every organization, every politician, every editor screamed for action and to hell with the book of rules. Those who clamored for a home in a hurry generally got it. In this period, some speculators made too much money. Others lost and received no sympathy. In the final audit, the United States government didn't lose a cent. The moral is that the emergency work of this world is not done either by critics or by constipated comma chasers. There were some isolated cases of bad planning in those days, some poorly designed developments, some deplorable subdivisions, some weak building inspection, and some failures to anticipate future utility, school, recreation, and transportation needs. But the overwhelming proportion of all the building in this crash program was remarkably good. Honest work accomplished under most trying conditions. People forget these things. The mood of the public changes. After the emergency, all sorts of lurid disclosures are played up. Few clear voices of courage, sanity, and fairness are raised. There is much gleeful pouncing on windfalls, hoarse yelling for blood, hunting for scapegoats, and stabbing of corpses. History is now repeating itself.
A small fee in America.
Okay. Buying on credit is so nice.
One look at us and they charge twice.
I have my own washing machine.
What will you have though to keep clean?
Skyscrapers bloom in America. Cadillac zoom in America. Industry boom in America.
12 in a room in America.
New housing with more space.
Lots of doors slamming in our face.
I'll get a terrace apartment.
Better get rid of your accent.
Life can be bright in America.
If you can fight in America.
Life is all right in America.
If you're all white in America.
As you stay on your own side.
Free to be anything you choose.
Free to wear devils and shine shoes.
Everywhere crime in America. Organized crime in America. Terrible time in America.
You forget I'm in America.
To San Juan.
I know a boat you can get on. Bye-bye.
Uh-huh. Everyone there will give big cheer.
Hey! Everyone there will have moved here. Oh.
Nosotros los puertorriqueños y todos los oprimidos por el terror y la violencia hemos tenido que acudir y no vacilará Puerto Rico si necesario fuera a este último recurso de las nacionalidades que es el uso de las armas para realizar su emancipación nacional. El imperio norteamericano se obstina en su ocupación de nuestro país y nos provoca día a día y noche a noche a la defensa de nuestra dignidad nacional. Somos víctimas de su violencia y de su terror. Nosotros hemos tratado todos los medios pacíficos en cuyo proceso el enemigo norteamericano se ha fortalecido.
That boy ain't right.
We're creating something that has a compression of energy.
I wanna help with that.